It's Fran, again. In the lab, I've still got the GC-1000 Heathkit's most accurate clock on the bench, and a lot of comments about that little mini-mail video about this little thing, and so I wanted to make another little video exploring a common problem with this clock that is displayed through many comments that the voltage regulators in these things tend to blow up, and that the solid-state modern DC-DC switch mode converter that is in this clock is apparently a common upgrade, although in this case I don't think it really works, and I wanted to kind of focus on these kinds of linear power supplies and what I see as a fatal flaw in the design of the Heathkit GC-1000. The Heathkit's using a pretty standard linear power supply, using a commercial universal transformer. It's got two primaries and a single secondary winding, no center tap. They do this because with these two primary coils, if you tack them together in series, it's a 240 volt. And if you wire them in parallel, it's 120 volt. So the Heathkit has primaries wired for 120, but it's really the secondary that's the issue. 12 volts AC, and they use a full bridge rectifier, full wave bridge rectifier. And then they do add some caps, and which is nice. You know, they got like a 0.1 and like a 2200 mic, and they even put a little choke, like a 23 or 29, I think it's 23 microhenry, but it's like a choke for you know, blocking interference on the line. That's all great. A couple more caps. but eventually, you're going to get to a voltage regulator, which they used a kind of a rebranded version of a 7805. It's a version of a 7805 5-volt regulator. And they use a dropping resistor in here, a power resistor, to drop the voltage a little bit more on the way. But here's the real problem is the transformer. 12 volt AC transformer, ultimately you want to get 5 volts DC regulated, right? Now there is an 8 volt supply that runs the radio board, which has its own little unheat-synced regulator, but the bulk of the current is coming from the 5 volt supply because it's running the display. LED display takes a lot of current, it's running two processors, yada yada. So the bulk of the whole power supply is going to this 5-volt supply. So 12 volts AC. With a full-wave bridge rectifier, you're going to get, without any load on it, you're going to get something to the order of the AC voltage times the square root of 2, or approximately 12 times 1.414. And that's going to give you the pretty close to what the unloaded power supply is going to be, 1.414, which is going to be in the area of about 17 volts DC. 17 volts. So it's got to drop 17 to 5. That's a huge jump. But with power supplies, there's always a difference between the unloaded DC that you get after the bridge and the loaded supply, because there's going to be a fluctuating load on this. You've got the display running different characters, you have two processors running with different loads, so it's going to vary. But under load, you're going to have a certain amount of voltage drop, but it's not going to be much, maybe a few volts. You're still going to have an awful lot of voltage coming all the way to the voltage regulator here. So in order to take some of that heat off, they put a resistor here. I think it's 3.5 ohms. They have it removed when they put in the switching supply, but it's like somewhere in the area of like 3.5 ohms, 5 watts usually. And those are usually sat up off of the board. You know, you don't want to put them against the board. You put them up with the leads up so that because they get hot and radiate heat, and that that'll drop the voltage a little bit going to the voltage regulator. But even so, it's obvious that these voltage regulators with a huge heat sink, and even in a case that has vent holes that, you know, it can be ventilated, even with that, these things tend to blow. Now, the engineers are going to be saying, oh, well, Fran, it's easy because all the caps and the power supply and everything start to get dodgy, they get leaky, they start to pull more current at startup, yada, yada, and eventually, you know, it's just, you know, you're overloading the regulator. It's all true. But, you know, in order for a linear regulator to really have a long life and operate within its spec, you really want to reduce the amount of voltage that it's going to have to dissipate to get down to its target voltage. If it's dropping close to 15 volts, anywhere near that, you're really pushing the regulator. You want it to be, you know, within 5 volts or so, because you need, I think, a minimum headroom of like 1.25 volts or 1.5 volts, usually with regulators, for them to regulate. So you have to have at least like a volt and a half to 2 volts on the input side of the regulator to get good regulation on the other side with changes in the current and load and such. So if it's anywhere near 8 volts on this side would be ideal for a 5 volt output. But what I want to do is actually measure the voltage going into the regulator, where the regulator would be, because they've taken out this resistor and replaced it with a jumper wire in the actual clock. Yeah, right down here. So when they changed out the linear regulator here and put in the switch mode converter, they took out this resistor down here. That's where the really big-ass 5-watt composite, because those are usually composite resistors, and it's been replaced with this jumper. What I'm going to do is I'm going to actually clip that jumper and strip the wire, and just so I can put a current meter on that and actually take a look at what the clock draws on startup and running and also the different displays. So it's like Radio Shack wire, that solid core Radio Shack wire they used to sell. All right, I'm just going to put some clips on that. Alrighty, so got set in amp mode, and got that. Okay, got it going the right direction. Okay, let's see what the startup current is for this clock. Okay, I got it going the wrong direction. 56 milliamps. Guess if I can get in test mode. All right. So with the full display on, because in test mode it's displaying all 8s, so that's maximum display. 274 milliamps. Well, that's not hardly anything at all. Okay, let's get into operational mode. Okay, so I guess the processor's boot up. Now that's interesting because when I started it, it wasn't drawing any current, right? So, it just dropped there. Okay, so it's fluctuating around, you know, 200, 250 milliamps, even though I've got the current going the wrong direction. I just assumed that towards the regulator would have been the direction, but it's obviously the PCB's wired the other way. Fine, whatever. So, all right, so we've got some fluctuation. All right. 200, so about 200 milliamps. Now, this is well within the spec. There, 200 milliamps for a voltage regulator like a 7805, that's nothing. It's nothing. I mean, you could go up to an amp amp and a half with a heatsink like this, continuous running, no problem. So it's not a matter of the current draw, really. It's really a matter of the voltage drop that the regulator has to take going from upwards of 17 volts at the rectifier all the way down to 5. So really the solution to the problem is getting an appropriate transformer that would be delivering an initial rectified voltage that would be much closer to 8 or 9 volts rather than double digits, so that we can, you know, get the rectifier running at a cooler temperature. And we wouldn't need the sink resistor to drop the voltage down ahead of the regulator. We could just go right from the choke to the regulator if we just had a lower initial voltage. So I'm just going to reattach that trumper wire. So I said before that the unloaded DC that you get out of a full-wave rectifier is based on that factor of multiplying the AC voltage times the square root of 2. But with the load on it, there's going to be some drop. So what I want to test is the actual voltage going into the regulator itself based on what we saw the current draw, which isn't much. It's like 250 milliamps or something like that. It's not much at all. So let's power it up again. All right. I got to jiggle it to get it to power up fully. Okay, now we're on full. So I'm going to take the negative rail off the rectifier and go over here to the jumper going into the regulator. Okay, 13.8 volts. Okay, so yeah, so it's, so it's dropped like, 4 volts. 13.8 going in, so it's dropping 13.8 volts with operational current to 5 volts regulated. That's we're talking more than double, almost triple the voltage. And this is where we're getting the heat damage. It's just dropping way too much voltage. So what are some of the solutions to this? Okay, so what can we do? We measured from the actual power supply that although it would be outputting somewhere around 17 volts out of the rectifier without any load on it, that with the load, it's dropping about 3.5 volts off of that. So it was because it was somewhere in the neighborhood of like 13.8 volts or something. I think it was 13.8 volts DC. That's still a lot, but even with a 3-volt drop from the load on the transformer, if we had somewhere in the neighborhood of 9 volts coming out of there, we'd be pretty much in the ballpark for a good voltage for the regulator rather than 17 volts. if we had the voltage out of the bridge rectifier somewhere in the neighborhood of 9 volts, would be good for this, and that regulator wouldn't be running so hot, and maybe not even hot at all. So 9 volts divided by 1.414, so 6.3 volts. So 6.3, so if the transformer were ideally, let's say, a 6.3 volt center tapped, then you would have a really well-designed power supply, and that regulator really wouldn't be running hot. We wouldn't have this bodgy big resistor. We would just go right from the bridge right to the regulator. It would be a sensible voltage drop, and that regulator wouldn't be screaming hot. And a 6.3 volt center tapped transformer, those were just as common as 12 volt. So why didn't they do that? It's a very good question. Heathkit, unlike what you would think, well, it's because it's built down to a cost. But no, I mean, if you know anything about Heathkit, it's just the opposite. They spared no expense with components. But they do have a history particularly with the clocks, because my other clock that I have, it has the same kind of ridiculous power resistor that melts the board, and they were just notorious for overdoing the supply voltage for things that they made. It was sort of, I guess, a design philosophy, you know, overdo it on this end, well, we'll just punish the voltage regulation on that end, or we'll just have a huge, big, 5-watt or 10-watt resistor that's just going to get red hot, that's going to drop the voltage down to somewhere where we need it. Just do total overkill on this side, worry about it later on that end, as if we maybe had two different divisions of Heathkit between the division that was buying the parts and saying, oh, we only want these really big transformers with really high output voltages, and the people actually designing the kits saying, you know, hey, you know, we want to regulate this down for 5 volts for, you know, a processor. Oh, well, you're going to have to deal with it. We're going to give you 17 volts and you'll just have to knock it down from there. But that's really the main issue. It's too hot on this side. Now, there is a workaround. I could just leave the transformer that's in here. It's a perfectly good transformer. It's way too overblown. But one thing you could do is to put a variac on here, drop the input voltage by, a good third, and get the output here lower. Dropping down the input voltage here, as long as you're maintaining the current with a variac, I've got bucket loads of these little 3-amp, 5-amp variacs that I got from the University of Pennsylvania Hall, and I could try just using one of these variacs just for this clock to drop down the voltage. I just have to put a probe on there and get it to the point where it's not screaming the regulator anymore. Or I can also check my stock. I'm sure I've got some 6.3-volt transformers. Although, there, like I said, there is another supply. It's an 8-volt regulated supply, but it's for the radio board, and it's not really running much current. They don't even have a heatsink on the regulator, so it could probably be within a volt and a half of 8 volts. So if it's anywhere like near 9.5 volts, that would probably run too. Anyway, forgive my terrible drawing. I'm drawing upside down at a side because I'm actually off to the side, drawing sideways. It's because the camera's over there. It's not like, you know, I guess I need like a helmet cam, like a camera mounted, like mounted to my glasses so that I can actually just point it right at, and I can actually, because if I were actually, this is the angle if I were actually drawing it. So anyway, that's it for this one. Thanks for watching. Thanks to all my patrons over there on Patreon, keeping the lights on, making all these videos possible. It's true. If you like what I do, if you like this video or any of my videos, then consider becoming a patron. It's easy to do. You just click the link in the description, become a patron. All right. That's it. I'm Fran. See you around the lab real soon. Bye! Berserk in my lab, it's where I work. What you're watching. Fran Lab. It's what I'm doing. Working at the bench again.